Open up your Bibles to the book of Revelation. We are going through the book of Revelation. We've gotten through chapter 1, and in chapter 2, we are going through the different letters to the different churches. There were seven churches that letters were written to, and actually this is one letter that is written to these seven churches. And each of these churches has things that Jesus likes about the way they do things in church. And these churches also have things that Jesus doesn't like. Jesus has encouragements for them, and he also has exhortations for them in places where they need to change. Now, there's a couple of them that Jesus has nothing bad to say. He just tells them to have faith and be faithful. And to, you know, not let anybody steal what they've got. And other ones, it's like, isn't there anything good that they have to show for the fact that Jesus redeemed them with his own lifeblood? So, these messages, it wasn't like, okay, Jesus is just going to share, you know, personally, just with that church, okay, this is where you're okay, and this is where you need to change. No, he's given these to everybody, and we have these written here for our learning, for us to see what is God like and what God doesn't like. Does it make one of these churches look bad in front of the other churches? Wouldn't that seem like that's kind of accusatory, and that would be kind of mean for Jesus to air somebody else's dirty laundry? No, he's a just and holy God. And if somebody is sinning against him, they need to know, but others also need to learn from that correction. Now, I say that because each one of us is going to have our own job review, so to speak. If you ever got a job and you got to go to the boss and say, here's your review, you know, and how have you been doing? This is where you need to get better. It doesn't mean that you're fired. It just means, okay, here's the standard that the boss has got. This is where you have done well, and this is where you haven't done well. Well, every one of us has a job review, and it's called the judgment seat of Christ, the Bema Seat Judgment. This is not the great right throne judgment where all the unbelievers are going to go, and they're going to have to answer for every thought, word, and deed before a holy God, and where they're going to have to pay now in the lake of fire for all of their sin because they rejected what Jesus did on the cross for them. That's a whole different judgment. There's a judgment for the church, for people who are believers. And we got to stand before God and answer. And this is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Paul talks about it. And there is a point of our walk with Christ where we need to have a judgment seat of Christ viewpoint. I mean, I don't want to be surprised that I've been doing things wrong and I've lost my eternal reward. Not to say I'm not going to go to heaven, but I've got nothing to show for this life that Jesus has redeemed. I don't need to come to the end of my life and say, oh, I could have done better. No, we've got God's Word that tells us what God loves and what God hates. And we can live every day with that idea, okay, is Jesus going to be pleased with this behavior? I don't want to be surprised when there's no more time in my life to do anything to show Jesus how much I love him. I want to keep that in my mind all the time. A lot of people think, okay, the judgment seat of Christ is just me and Jesus and nobody else is going to know. When I see these letters to the seven churches, I don't think that's the case. I think everybody's going to know what we've done bad and what we've done good. Because Paul says that we're going to be judged what we've done in the body, good and bad. If he just said good, okay, I'm just going to go there and get my reward. Like you won, you know, at the track meet, you got the 100-yard dash, and you're going to go and you get your first place ribbon. Yay! No, it's a little bit more than that. Otherwise, he wouldn't have the word bad in there. So everybody's going to know. Now, everybody's also going to know that it's Jesus' blood that's redeemed me from the bad. But I still have to answer to my God, to my sovereign, to my king, with what I have done with my body. Now, I know I'm bringing this stuff up, but that's how it fits in with these letters to the churches. Jesus is giving them a job review. How you doing as a church taking care of my people? Are you doing things the right way? Now in chapter 2, the first part, we got the church of Ephesus. They did everything great. I mean, they had a ministry for everything. And if there was somebody who was a false prophet, they'd kick him out. If somebody was a false teacher, they'd kick him out. If somebody was not doing things the right way, if somebody was trying to act like, as Jesus says, you know, the lords of the Gentiles, they lorded over those little ones. You know, they lorded over whoever. It's like if going to church means, you know, you're working your way up into some kind of CEO position till you're a senior pastor somewhere, and now you got autonomous and you can step on anybody underneath you and they gotta do what you say because you can't touch the Lord's anointed. No. They got kicked out for doing stuff like that. They got kicked out for that kind of stuff. Man's idea of leadership is different than God's idea of leadership. The world's idea of leadership is the unjustified means, you got passion, you're going to get her done, you don't care what it costs to get things done. And so you win at sports because you're stepping on people and you're kicking them in the knee and you're tripping them and you're doing all these bad things that hopefully nobody will catch so that you win and so that the other people lose. That's the world's way. No, God's way is you want to be great in the kingdom of heaven? The greatest in the kingdom of heaven is the servant of all. You wanna be great for an eternity and look good in front of everybody else who's been saved by Jesus? Then be a servant of everybody. Which means it's not how many people you tell what to do that makes you big, but how many people you are taking care of that makes you big. It's a whole different way of looking at things. So if you got a senior pastor, oh, he must have some great position for an eternity with God because he's in charge of this great big congregation. Well, if he's just pointing his finger and telling people how to do all this stuff and what to do, and they better do it, or they're not going to jump up to the next level in leadership in this church, then you have got nothing for an eternity. It's all going to burn. But the person who is taking care of everybody, the person who is serving everybody, the person who is meeting the needs of others and caring for them, as a mommy takes care of her baby, as a daddy takes care of his children, those are the ones who are going to get the reward in heaven. Anyway, these people in Ephesus did a great job on doing that. They were doing things the right way. But with all of their hard work doing things the right way, they left their first love. So that's what Jesus had against them. They're doing all these great things for God, but they left God behind in the dust. Very sad. So we call our church First Love Bible Fellowship because we don't want to pursue ministry to the expense of our own personal relationship with the lover of our soul, Jesus Christ. The one who loved us enough to stay on that cross, to pay for every bad thing we would ever do. I want that to be the most important thing. And not even serving Him, not in serving others. But I want Jesus to be the most important thing. The next church that we got is the Church of Smyrna. Now, Jesus didn't have anything bad to say to the Church of Smyrna. They were under severe persecution. They were suffering greatly because of their love for their Lord. And Jesus gives them commendation for that. And he also says, don't be afraid of what more is going to come. He says Satan's going to take some of you and he's going to put you in prison. You're going to have tribulation for 10 days. I mean, it's like, as bad as things are right now, don't be afraid. Things are going to get worse. It's not like, you know, don't worry, be happy. No, he says, don't worry. Don't be afraid. It's going to get worse. But the one who overcomes, he has overcome all the hurt of the second death. You're not going to have to experience a second death. The one who overcomes, you get a crown of life. Everybody for an eternity is going to know that you suffered for your love for me. For an eternity, you're going to be wearing this crown of life. Everybody's going to see you for an eternity and say, wow, in your life, you suffered for Jesus. In your life, you were willing to die. In fact, you did die because Jesus was worth it. Now, that's what they get. No rebukes, just encouragement. And also saying, hey, things aren't getting better. There isn't any light at the end of the tunnel until you are with me. And then you're going to receive from me an accommodation that everybody's going to know. And now we get the next one, the Church of Pergamos. And they have a tough thing, and Jesus commending them for the tough stuff that they're dealing with. And he says, I know that that's where Satan's seat is. We talked a little bit about what Satan's seat was. It could have been this big temple that was dedicated to Zeus. And it was kind of a U-shaped, you know, altar that kind of looks like a throne. And so people thought that had to do with Satan. But there was also this place called this temple for Asclepius, and this was, you know, they had snakes going around everywhere, and people were supposed to get healed when they touched the snake, and all kind of weird stuff. But it was all demonic, and snake is Satan, you know? So there was lots of weird demonic stuff. It was definitely a stronghold for Satan in that place. And so, you know, Jesus knew what they were going through, but he says, I got this stuff against you. You're following the doctrine of Balaam. Well, Balaam was this prophet for profit in the Old Testament, the book of Numbers. We read about him. He was the one who he was gonna try to curse Israel, but he couldn't because God blessed Israel. You can't, and he realized, you know, you can't curse somebody who God doesn't want to curse. You can only, so whenever he got in a high place and tried to curse Israel, the only thing that came out was blessings for Israel. So it didn't work. No matter what he could try to do with his mouth, it didn't work. But then the king, King Balak, who hired him to try to get Israel to, because Israel's creeping up in Balak's territory. So he says, okay, you got to do something. So then he realized, well, the only way we can get Israel to be cursed is to make them ugly in the sight of their own God. So he got them to basically have immorality with the Moabite women, the people of his country. He would send the pretty girls in and seduce the young men. And they would have sexual immorality, and as they were doing that, they were eating food that was sacrificed to an idol, and they would worship this false idol that they had. And God had to curse them, because they had now broken covenant with their God. And 24,000 people were killed by God. So it worked. Balaam figured out a way to get God to curse his own people, because they were doing things to break their covenant relationship with God. Well, this church was allowing teaching that had something to do with that. Which means this teaching says, well, it doesn't matter. You can, you know, sexual immorality, you know, I mean, yeah, it's just an urge that goes on. It's not that big a deal. You know, we got grace for that. It's okay. And a lot of these big mega churches, you got people having adulterous relationships all over the place. You got people who are sleeping with each other. You got singles who are shacking up. And you come to church and you shake somebody's hand next to you and you say, God bless you and praise the Lord. And everybody thinks it's okay. Because all you care about is somebody in church thinking that you're somebody special. You might even have a word of God for them, and they think, oh, you're just some religious hotshot. You know, wow, I want to hear from God. And you know, Satan can give people exactly the words that somebody else needs to hear. And you think you're filled with the Spirit saying these wonderful things, and people are just loving it. But you're pursuing immorality. And it's not the Holy Spirit. It's a deceitful spirit. Well, that's what was going on. And then he says, and you also hold to the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. Well, he commended the church of Ephesus for not going along with that doctrine. Nicolaitans were these people. It was either a form of Gnosticism, which we had talked about, but it was the idea, the name has to do with conquering. You've seen the word Nike on your shoes? Well, that's that word, Nike, Niko, means conquer. And then Laetans is laity, that's people. So conquering the people. So it's talking about what you see in most denominations. You know, you've got the folks who are in charge, and then you know they're like in charge of the entire denomination, and then you got the people underneath them, which are called the bishops, and then the bishops are in charge of the senior pastors, and then the senior pastors are in charge of, you know, the associate pastors, and then you got the assistant pastors, and then you got the lay, and then you got the youth leaders, and then you finally get down to the laity. The people. And you got to do what the next guy above you says. It's like, no, there's only one mediator between God and man, the man Jesus Christ. I don't have to answer to my pastor. I don't have to answer to somebody's senior pastor or to somebody's bishop. I answer to Jesus Christ. And that's who we all have to answer to for every thought, word, and deed anyway. But they get this thing. It's a pyramid. The guy, the CEO is up on top. There's a book came out, you know, Jesus CEO. No, Jesus is not the CEO. No, the pyramid's upside down. Jesus serves everybody. And he gives them what they need to serve everybody. It's the pyramid is upside down. It's not like this. It's not how many people are you tell what to do to make you important. No, it's how many people are you taking care of that makes you important in Jesus' eyes. How many people are you serving? You want to be great in the eyes of Jesus? Ask Jesus to make you a servant. Well, make you a servant. In the New Testament, that word servant, it's not the way we think a servant. I mean, we think a servant is, okay, you do the job and you get the money. You know, you work 9 to 5 or whatever it is. You know, it's like No, the word in Greek is basically slave. Who wants to be a slave? The writers of the New Testament call themselves the bond slave of Jesus Christ. They call themselves the slave of Jesus Christ. A slave has no mind of his own. He does what he's told. That's what makes him a good slave. A slave doesn't think, well, I got a better way of doing this, master. No, you do it exactly what the master does. You meet your master's expectations. But I could be more efficient. I wouldn't have to work so hard. I could be smarter than this. We could do things a different way around here. Just do what I told you to do. That's what it means to be a slave. Who wants to be a slave? It is completely opposite to this world system. This world system says you got to be in charge. You got to tell people what to do if you want to be in anybody. You got to ride first class. You got to live in a gated community. You got to do all this stuff. You got to be more important than everybody else. And Jesus says, no, the slave, that's the one who's greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Well, they were holding to the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, the ones who are lording over the people. And Jesus says, no, I have it. You got to repent of that. And he says, whoever does, I'm going to allow you to eat of the hidden manna. I'm going to give you white stone. We talked about that, the different meanings behind that last week. The hidden manna is not, well, I'm just going to go to the temple meat market and get the best price. No, you're going to stay away from stuff dedicated to idols so that you don't lead anybody into sin, as Paul says. In 1 Corinthians chapter 8, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, you're going to do things so that people can be saved and not stumbled. And so Paul says, you know, I'd rather be a vegetarian and not even eat meat. If it means that if I would eat meat, somebody would fall into sin, I'm not going to do that. So he says, you know, I'm going to give you hidden manna. I'm going to meet your needs. I'm going to give you what you need. You don't have to worry about doing things the world's way. I'm going to take care of you. Okay, now we get to the next one. Starting with verse 18 of Revelation chapter 2. And unto the angel of the church in Thyatira write, these things saith the Son of God, who hath his eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass. I know thy works, and charity, and service, and faith, and thy patience, and thy works, and the last to be more than the first. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed to idols. And I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. And I will kill her children with death. And all the churches shall know that I am he which searcheth the reins and the hearts. I will give unto every one of you according to your works. But unto you I say, and unto the rest in Thyatira, as many as have not this doctrine, and which have not known the depths of Satan as they speak, I will put upon you none other burden but that which ye have already, hold fast till I come. And he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him I will give power over the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, as the vessels of a potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received of my Father, and I will give him the morning star. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Lord Jesus, let us hear what you have to say as you are speaking to the church at Thyatira. Lord, give us understanding. But Lord, let it not just be information in our head, but Lord, let it change our heart, dear God, so we can do what is pleasing to you, dear Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, as we talked about each one of these cities, there are little cities in Asia Minor. There's a little map on top of there, right there on the thing next to that, if you want to look at that to see where they're at. But he's kind of following a little pattern. This is about 35 miles away from the last one as he's going around in a circle as he's writing these letters to them. We don't know much about Thyatira. It's not a really big, popular city. Some of these other ones were big cities, important cities. But it was a smaller city, but it was known for a few things. One of the things that it's known for is the other place where we see that word Thyatira in the Bible. Now, where did we ever see that word Thyatira in the Bible? Well, there was a lady from Thyatira. And her name was Lydia, and she was a seller of purple. Well, remember where Lydia, the seller of purple from Thyatira, came from? Paul and I think it was Barnabas. They were stuck in their missionary journey. They didn't know where to turn. They didn't know what to do. So this is, you know, like Acts chapter 15 and 16. And they're praying, and they try to go in one direction, and the Spirit of Jesus says no. They try to go in another direction, and they're hindered. They try to go in another direction, and the Holy Spirit says no. And they're praying. And it's like, we're supposed to continue this missionary journey, but we don't know what to do. All the doors are closed. I don't know what direction to go. And then that night, Paul has this dream. And he sees a man from Macedonia. He's got Macedonian clothes. He's dressed like a person from Greece. And he says, come help us. And so when he wakes up from the morning, he says, okay, we're going to go to Greece. So they go into Macedonia. They go into the city of Philippi. What's interesting, when you go through the book of Acts, we don't know who the man from Macedonia was. It was just a person in this dream. But in the book of Acts, when you read it, the book of Acts was written by who? It's written by Luke. When you get to this point, Luke starts using himself instead of, and he did that, and they did that, and they did that, and they went there, and he did this, to, we went here, and we went there. So I think the man from Macedonia was Luke. That's just my personal opinion, because the book of Acts all of a sudden goes from a third person to a first person in their pronouns. That's just my opinion. Otherwise, the first person that they see in Philippi wasn't a man. It was Lydia. It was this woman. And they didn't have enough Jews to get together to have a synagogue. So there was just a few lovers of God worshiping. And so Paul shared the gospel with them, showed them who the Messiah really was, that it's Jesus. And she got saved. She understood. And she was from Thyatira. Well, what was she doing? She was selling purple. Or she was selling purple garments. Well, Thyatira happened to be known for dyeing cloth a different way. There was, you know, there was the, like the North African way of dyeing cloth and the Phoenician way of dyeing cloth. And this was this little snail called a murex snail. And they would either crush a whole bunch of them to get this little drop of dye out, and you dye, and there's two different kinds. One snail one kind of snail would produce a blue color and another snail would produce a purple color. But it would take thousands just to dye a small piece of cloth. So you'd actually wipe out the population of these things. So what they would do is they would like poke and bother this little snail until it came out with this little drop of dye. And then they'd accumulate this and finally dye things with it. Well, that was really, really expensive. And the people who were anybody, they would wear purple. So if you wore purple, that means that you, you know, that's like wearing the name brand clothing, you know, whatever. Well, you were, they were dressed in purple. And you'll see, in when you read through Jesus' life, you'll see somebody dressed in purple. Well, when they were mocking Jesus, when he went to Herod, and they dressed him up like a king, they put this robe on him that was purple. They put this expensive thing on him to mock him, to make him look like a king as they were beating him up and everything else. And then they gave him back to Herod. Herod gave him back to Pilate. And that day, Pilate and Herod became friends because they both had a good time beating up on Jesus. Well, in Thyatira, they had this thing called a Maddox root. It was a plant that grew. And they would take these roots of this plant. And you can still buy these things. You know, to make your own dye. And there's various varieties. But they would take these roots and they would get the dye out of the roots. And it would be a red to orange color. And there was two different kinds of dyes that were in these roots. Some of them would be washed away. So the higher quality ones would be the darker, you know, purple or crimson color. All I have to say, who cares about dye? It was big bucks. It was big money. And Thyatira was known for dyeing fabrics like wool or whatever. Well, so what was Lydia doing for a living? She was selling the stuff that Thyatira made. She's from Thyatira, so she's taking this. She's a merchant, and she's on her trips. That's where Paul met her. So I think maybe Thyatira, the church there, probably got started because Lydia went back home to get more goods to sell. And she shared the gospel. People got saved. I don't know how, because we don't hear about anybody else going there. The only one we know is Lydia. Oh, praise God. Wherever God sends you, even if it's something mundane, okay? I gotta, you know, my work sent me to a different city. Or, hey, I gotta go to the hospital. Or, I gotta, you know, go ask my neighbor something. Or, I gotta go to the grocery store. There is an opportunity God is sending you. You just think it's some mundane task that you gotta do. No, God sent you there. Why? Because you got the gospel. And you got to say what you need to say. So somehow a church got started there. Well, Thyatira wasn't really known for a lot of other things. There was other different industries they had, but they were also known about their trade guilds. It's kind of like unions. Now, we live in an open state, free state, or whatever you want to call it. You don't have to belong to a union to work anywhere. You might get beat up and they might call you a scab for certain industries that are basically controlled by the unions here, but you can still legally do it. Now, there's other states that are union states, and you gotta be a member of the union if you want to get a job in that industry. Well, there were trade unions, trade guilds. Well, these trade guilds were connected with a false deity. Which means whatever you did for a living, you had to be a part of that trade guild or you weren't going to get work. Well, to be a part of that trade guild is not just like being a teamster or something. IFOC, however it is, AFL-CIO, whatever kind of union you want to be in, it's not like that. Because ours here in this country are all secular. Theirs were connected with a certain god or goddess that was their patron, that protected them, that gave them benefits, that made their merchandise sell better. So there was more problems there than here. It's no big deal to be a member of a union here. I mean, you know, Maybe by the end of your life you'll have some kind of, whatever you call it, pension or something from the union. I mean, that's, you know, my dad's got a pension, praise God, you know, but not everybody gets that. Open state, you can work for minimum wage anywhere, you know. Anyway, all that to say, my dad didn't have to worship at some false god's idol. But these people would have had to. Because they would have had to submit to whatever false god that trade guild was associated with. So that was a problem. Now, some of the gods that were there in Thyatira, I'm saying this stuff because it connects with why he said what he said. They had a god, and his name was Terimnus. And Terimnus basically got changed to the Roman god Apollo. Well, Terimnus was basically the god of the sun. And he had this battle axe with an edge on either side. And he rode on a horse. And he was the god of the sun. So they worshipped this character. They also had this Sibylline thing, which is it's like a psychic, like a prophet, like, you know, and they had this temple to, like, a mother god, like the mother of all, the great mother. Well, that comes down to our day, because there's lots of Gaia worship right now. They're worshiping Mother Earth. I mean, there's a lot of that going on. I mean, you get somebody, you know, and the New Age has brought a lot of this mother God worship into the church. You got, you know, Sue Monk Kidd. She used to be a Baptist Sunday school teacher. She got into the New Age, and she basically denied her faith in it. It's getting people to worship Gaia now. It's pretty sad. And for any Christian book that quotes Sue Monk Kidd, you got to wonder where they're going or where they've already gone. I would throw the book away and burn it. Because the woman has nothing to do with Jesus Christ. She is worshiping the mother of all. What's interesting is St. Peter's Square. They found several, like 24 shrines to the mother of all. Huh. Make the connection. They're worshiping Mother Mary. This isn't Jesus' mom that they're worshiping. This is the female demonic thing that is claiming to be mother of all. All these Catholics who are praying to Mary, who want Mary to intercede, who is now co-redemptrix, who suffered with Jesus. This goes right back to this mother of all, this. And if you look into the religion of this person, who had these psychics, these priestesses, these prophetesses from them. It was a matriarchal, it was a woman in charge. That's part of their culture. You grow up always seeing this and hear this thing. Well, they're spread all over Europe that were put there by, you know, the Romans as they conquered the Western world. And the Greeks. It's a real popular thing. There she was on her throne, and she's got a lion on either side. And she's in charge of the earth. And she has a chariot that's driven by two lions. And they used to do, in the Roman world, they would have two tamed lions, and they would be drinking out of a bowl or eating food out of a bowl. And that would symbolize this mother of God worship, as though you can't see her, but those are her two lions that are doing her bidding, who are tamed by her. Now, why am I bringing this up? This is the culture of Thyatira. It's a pagan place, like all these other ones were. They were all pagan. They're completely given over to false gods and things. But it had a lot to do with the culture that people grew up under. Now, I grew up in a Christian culture. You could have the expectation to talk to somebody and they had gone to Sunday school at some point, or they had gone to vacation Bible school sometime in their life. You can't say that anymore. Because they've gotten prayer out of schools, they've got the Bible out of schools, they've got Jesus out of the schools, and now these kids are growing up not knowing who Jesus Christ is except for a curse word, not ever going to a church, never going to a Sunday school or Christian day school or a vacation Bible school or any of that stuff. Now they don't have a clue. It's a post-Christian culture. Our culture has completely lost Jesus Christ as part of who it was. So the new generation is different from the old generation, just within our own lifetimes. The new generation doesn't have a clue about Jesus, doesn't understand about morality. You just do what seems the best, and it's okay. They grew up with situational ethics. Things might be wrong in certain cases, but it might be okay in other cases. I mean, that's what happened since I was a kid. That all changed. Why am I saying that? Because the culture of Thyatira was seeing this woman in charge, was seeing this sun god, was, you know, plus the normal things that were going on. If you wanted a job, you had to submit to whatever god or goddess was in charge of your trade guild. Now Christianity gets there. There's only one God. He loved you enough to become a human and be punished for all of your sins on a cross. And he calls you to himself. He says, repent of your sins and I'll forgive you. He says, make me Lord of your life. Follow my teachings. Be born again. Be changed forever. And things were happening. And there's all these people who got saved. And they'll never be the same again. And they're completely anti-cultural. It has nothing to do with the culture anymore. They're doing their own thing. Now, a Christian working at a certain trade, it's no different. You're going to share your faith with the unbelievers. But you're supposed to worship that God who's in charge of your trade guild. Now what do? Now things get more difficult. Okay. That's kind of the background of Thyatira. Under the angel of the church of Thyatira write, these things saith the Son of God. Now, this is the only place in the book of Revelation that calls Jesus the Son of God. He's called the Son of Man. Now, the Son of Man we can relate to because God became a human being so that he could relate with us. I can relate to the Son of Man. God became a man. Now I know God because I know Jesus and I know what he taught. And he tells me and shows me what God is like. I've got a mediator between me, who is a sinner, to a holy God. And that's Jesus Christ. Now, Jesus calling himself Son of God is a little bit more unapproachable than a Son of Man. This is God talking. This isn't somebody who just understands what you're going through. No, this is the authority of the universe talking. This is how he introduces himself. These things saith the Son of God. Now, I think that might have to do also with these other beings that they were worshiping. No, there's the one true God. Jesus is his Son. He's God the Son. And then he says, who hath his eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass. Now, we read this earlier in chapter 1. As Jesus shows up, and he's talking to John, and he's given John the instructions to write down what he sees, the things that are, and the things that will be. And he turns and he sees what Jesus is really like. And, you know, his head and his heart, this is 1 verse 14, his head and his hairs were like wool, as white as snow, his eyes were as a flame of fire, and his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burn in the furnace, and his voice sound of many waters, and his right hand he had seven stars out of his mouth, went a two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shining in his strength. And John saw that, and he fell at his feet like a dead man. He saw Jesus. Not the one at the Lord's Supper where his head was actually on the chest of Jesus as they were eating, as he was reclining. No, this is God the Son. And he falls down in Jesus' presence like a dead man. This is what God is like. But Jesus didn't leave him laying there. He laid his right hand on him, saying, fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and is dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and death. So John got recuperated when Jesus touched him. The way that John saw Jesus, different aspects of what John sees is the way Jesus introduces himself to the various churches. So each church has a part of this as Jesus introduces himself. So the way that Jesus introduces himself to the church of Thyatira isn't, oh, I want to put my arms around my sweet Jesus and I love him. This is the Son of God, God the Son, who's coming to judge. And he says, I am God the Son. I've got the eyes like a flame of fire. Now, eyes like a flame of fire, that kind of freaks you out. What is that? Well, that means that his eyes don't just see what the light reflects, but his eyes also produce light to see what people can't see, to see what's hidden in the dark, to see all the way down inside. Now, if you get a broken leg or something, you got to go to the hospital, what do? They put your leg or whatever in an x-ray. And what is an x-ray? There are these certain rays of light that are very small and they go right through. And they let you see the inside. Well, that's the idea. Jesus' eyes of flame are, there's nothing prohibiting what he needs to see. And he sees everything all the way through. Nothing is blocked from his sight. Now, because it's fire, we're talking about judgment. He has eyes like under a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass. Now, when we first were up here in chapter 1, verse 14, we talked about that. And this word for fine brass, we don't see anywhere else. It's the combination of the word for frankincense and the word for brass. Well, frankincense in its resin form is white. It's a bright white color. So in other words, this is a fine enough brass to be used for worship, but it's also a well-refined brass that it might even be something like a white gold, something highly precious, highly refined. But it also can be talking about refining the fire. Well, brass is the metal that also designates God's judgment. In the tabernacle and in the temple, there was an altar, and it was covered with brass. That's where the animals were sacrificed. So why did an animal need to get sacrificed? Because somebody sinned. Somebody sinned. And without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. So that animal had to be slain, and that animal had to be burned up. So that God could cover that sin, not look at it, and you could be reconciled to a holy God because that sin would be covered. Well, Jesus is the Lamb of God who was slain. Jesus died so that when he died, he didn't just cover our sin, he took it away. So whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life because you place your faith in the fact that Jesus was punished for your sins. God turns his eyes of wrath away from you, that you deserve God's wrath for every time you did anything bad. But Jesus took the punishment in our place. It's not just him just, okay, I'm just going to cover your sin till you sin again. No, I'm taking away your sin because Jesus is God the Son. He's not some animal who didn't sin, who now, because an innocent animal got cut up and burned, and now your sin is covered for a little while. No, this is the eternal God who became man, and he died on the cross so he could take our sin away. And now whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. Well, here is his feet like fine brass. There isn't any impurity. When you keep putting metal in the fire and melting it and taking off the dross and melting, there is no impurity there. And brass is judgment. So here Jesus is coming to Thyatira. Not, oh, you can just be faithful another day. You just need endurance. You can go. No, he is there. I got something to say to you and you need to repent. Now that wouldn't be very nice. That wouldn't be very cool. But all these letters are written so that when we see where we're going to fit in here, when the shoe fits, you put it on, you say, okay, the Holy Spirit is saying this is where you need to repent. Well, we've got a God that sees everything. He sees the good, bad, and the ugly. Now, he'll never forget anything that we've done in his name. But he also sees every bad thing. He knows every bad thought, every bad word. He's seen every bad deed. Nothing is hidden from him. Now, when we're tempted, we can say, okay, I'm going to go do this, and Jesus, don't look at me right now while I go do this thing that I know you don't like. No, you can't. His eyes are burning fire. I mean, he's going to see it. He knows the intention of your heart. He knows when you're planning on doing something bad. And he sees it all. Well, this is the Jesus who is coming to Thyatira. For as much as it sounds like he's going to come on hard by the way he's introducing himself, he is still the one that died on the cross for their sins. He's the one who already put his life on the line to take away their sins. They have nothing but motivation to be pleasing to him. But if they are refusing to be pleasing, well, now you've got Jesus coming back as a judge. Verse 19, I know thy works. It says, I know all the hard work you do in my name. I know everything that you're doing. I know it. And charity. This is the word, the Greek word agape. Now, the church of Ephesus, they left their first love. They left their love for Jesus Christ to pursue ministry. Well, he's saying, I know your agape. Obviously, it's general. It's not specific to anything, which means your love for me and your love for everybody else in your life. Your love for my children, for your brothers and sisters in Christ. I know it. Which means he's commending them for their hard work. He's commending them for their agape love. Now, agape love is more than just friendship. If you're a friend, you go halfway, they come halfway. And if they don't come there halfway, then, well, that's not really my friend then. No, agape love is not just doing your half, but doing their half. And loving them and taking care of them, even when they don't even like it. When they reject you, and you love them anyway. When you're gonna give them what they need, even though they don't want it. It's loving those people who are stinky and ugly and mean. It's loving those people who are also your brothers and sisters in Christ, to the point of, I'm willing to die for you because I know how important you are to Jesus. Now that's agape love. That's the standard of loving that Jesus has set for us to follow, to love our brothers and sisters in Christ. I know thy works and thy charity and service. This is ministries. This is everything that you're doing. Well, you can't love somebody and not do something about it. You know, I mean, if you see somebody in need and you don't give them anything, is that really love? And we talked about that when we were in James. We talked about that when we were in 1 John. It would just be something comes out of your mouth, but it would be, you know, hypocrisy to not actually help them physically. So he says, I know your service. This all goes together. If you love somebody, you're going to help them. You're going to take care of them. You're going to do whatever situation that they need help in. That's service. And he says, and faith. I know that you are a believer. I know that you are being faithful with everything that's in you. You're being faithful to what you know. And he says, and thy patience. That word patience is not our idea of patience, like, oh man, how long is this going to take? Why do I always choose the longest line in a grocery store? How come there's always somebody that I got to wait for when I'm getting gas for my car? How come it's always taking so long? No, it's not that kind of patience. This is the word that we would understand as perseverance. Patience is kind of passive. Oh, when is this going to happen? When is it going to be over? Perseverance is, I'm going to go and it's hard and I'm doing it because I have to. If you're working out, why do you work out? Because you're trying to get stronger. If you're running laps, is that any fun? Does anybody like running laps? If you're doing push-ups, or even doing weight training, whatever it is that you're doing, is it any fun? Of course not. But why do you do it? Because you need to get stronger than you are now. And if you don't do what hurts your body, you're not going to get any stronger than you are now. Why do exercise? I'm physically fit for what I do right now. Who's saying that I'm not physically fit? Well, if you work harder, you're going to be physically fit to do something stronger, to have more endurance. The idea is endurance. Now, anybody just wanting to go hike down and up the Grand Canyon? Let's go do that. Well, I think half of us would probably fall at the side of the road dead because we couldn't do it. We got to work up to something like that. It's not just like walking on flat land. It's like doing a stair stepper for several miles. I mean, this ain't pleasant. You're probably going to hurt yourself if you haven't worked up the endurance to get it. Well, these people, Jesus is commending them for their endurance. Well, why do they have endurance? They have endurance because they're living in this pagan culture. And it's hard to even eke out a living in this pagan culture. When I think of, Lydia from Thyatira. She was one who had a fear of God. She was seeking the one true God. And she found that the one true God had made himself known in the Old Testament. That was the only Bible they got. That's why she was there with the Jews who were meeting together, even though there wasn't enough Jews there to have a synagogue. She was following the one true God. And then Paul shows up and enlightens her that this is Jesus. And Jesus is Messiah. And he came to be the suffering servant. Now he's going to be coming back as a conquering king. Well, how difficult would it be if you had only one God? In a culture that had multi-gods. And because there is only one God, you're not going to worship a false god. It's not going to be easy to live in a situation like that. So he says, I commend you for your endurance. And then he says, and your works, and the last to be more than the first. So in other words, I remember when you first started, you were just struggling along, but now you have done more things, and you're doing more things. You are doing more things to give me pleasure than you used to, which means they are moving forward in their relationship with God. They're moving forward in their service to others. They're moving forward in their endurance, in the signs of their agape love for each other. But then verse 20, we've got a notwithstanding. Ay, it's a but. It's a nonetheless. I mean, there's one of these things. You got the good, and then you're going to have to hear the bad. Now here comes the bad. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee. Because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed to idols. And I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. And I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he which searcheth the reins and the hearts, and I will give unto every one of you according to your works. Now here comes the bad part. I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest, thou allowest, that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach, and to seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed to idols. You're allowing a woman to teach. Is that a bad thing? There's lots of churches that have women pastors. They're sinning. Look it up in the Bible. Look it up in the New Testament. It's a sin. Paul says no. So what do these people who have woman pastors say? Oh, well, Paul just, it was a different culture. Well, why don't you call immorality a different culture? Why don't you call any kind of sin a different culture? Paul makes it really clear. Now, were there prophetesses? Yeah, there were prophetesses. All the way from the Old Testament, there were prophetesses, which means God is going to speak through a woman. Is that wrong? No, it's not wrong. But it's wrong for a woman to have authority over a man. It's against the biblical model. It's against the roles that God had created. There's various Bible passages that talk about this. In the book of 1 Timothy, when Paul sends Timothy to basically hold people accountable for not doing things the right way in Ephesus and these other churches. We call it a pastoral epistle. Well, he's going to have to hold some pastors accountable to God's word. And Paul says, I do not allow a woman to teach or have authority over a man. That's really clear. You can't understand the Greek any other way. And there is no exceptions. But that's not the world we live in. And the church looks more and more like the world every day, unless they go back to true north, the Bible. They go back to what the Bible says. Now, in the book of 1 Corinthians, Paul talks about, in chapter 12, he talks about the different spiritual gifts, manifestations. But as he's talking about it, he says, a woman needs to have her head covered. Well, what is the idea of a head covering? To show that she is under the authority of a man. So with the head covering, she's saying, I am under, if you're an unmarried woman, you're under the authority of your father. If you're married, you're under the authority of your husband. And he says, no woman should pray or prophesy in church without her head covered. Why? Because with the head covered, she is saying, I am under the authority of a man. Which means it's not her own authority. It's not, well, God told me and I'm going to tell you. Now, it's not as though a woman can't lead worship if she's under the authority of a man. Or she can't teach, but she can't teach men. She can't have authority over a man. It's very clear in 1 Timothy, and we got, you know, in 1 Corinthians 12. But she can teach, and we can go to the book of Titus, and it talks about the older women should basically mentor the younger women, how to love their husbands, how to, you know, the older women have a huge responsibility to teach the younger women how to be a good wife and how to be a good mom. In the 1 Timothy passage, Paul says that they're going to be saved by childbearing. Why? Because the moment a woman becomes a mommy, she's going to be a mommy for the rest of her life. It doesn't end. Oh yeah, once they're 18, they're out of the house. No, that, you know, you're still the mom forever. It's going to happen. It, from the time you give birth, you're their mom, and it's never going to go away. And she has a responsibility before God to train those children. Timothy was the perfect example of a young man who was trained by his mother and his grandmother, Lois and Eunice. These were God-fearing women who poured God's word into Timothy. So when Timothy heard who Messiah was, that it's Jesus Christ, he got saved. And everything he was told from the Bible all of a sudden became alive to him because he knew Jesus was Messiah. He was trained as a boy by his mother and his grandmother who poured God's word into him. Who's got the greater role, a pastor or a mother? A pastor talks to people, what, an hour and a half, however long they let him stand up there behind the pulpit. Once a week, maybe twice, maybe three times if you got an extra service. A mom is there 24 hours a day pouring God's word into that child. This is how Jesus would have you live your life. That is not God-pleasing. This is what's important. This is what we're going to follow. This is how we live our lives. We're not like them. You're not going to get what they got. You're going to get what God gives you. You're not going to strive after what is not God's will for you. All these things, mommy needs to tell me. Otherwise, I'm going to look like the rest of the world. I'm going to be a part of this ugly worldly culture that's whose expectations for life never get met. And you're going to be unhappy forever and you're going to end up committing suicide because life just isn't worth it. And how many people do we see doing that? And they got more than I'll ever have. And they end their life early. Because they couldn't get something just beyond what they wanted, and there's still no fulfillment. No, here's mommy telling you, you can trust your Heavenly Father. He knows your needs, and He'll give you what is the desire of your heart. Just trust Him. Just ask Him. Just ask Him specifically what you want. And He is going to give it to you. I mean, it's a miracle. And you won't even know how it happened, but there it is. Because He loves you that much, and He really wants to give you what is the desire of your heart. Well, a mommy needs to trust God enough that she's believing that herself in order to tell her son or daughter that. Do they have a lesser role? No, it's a really important role. Because the family unit was designed by God. And that's where we find out about God. That's where we learn how to trust God. But here, they are allowing this woman to teach which means she's got authority over man. She's got authority over the church in Thyatira. You know, there are several cults. Now, what's a cult? It's kind of like Christianity. They got the Bible, but they take things out of context and make it mean what it doesn't mean. And they fuse into a few little passages or a few words of a passage things that were never intended. Most of the cults were started by a woman. Here was a cult started by a woman in Thyatira. That's what's going on. There's a cult in Thyatira, and it's not Christianity. But it's right, it's bumping up against the real Christians. And they got a woman prophetess as their pastor. We got our own prophet. I got a problem with these ladies who consider themselves prophets and they're preaching on the radio. I got a problem with that. They need to be under authority of a man. It's not as though God can't use a prophet who's a woman. He does. And it's not just Old Testament. There was Huldah. She was the only one who was available. I don't know where Jeremiah was, but she was the only one available to give God's word to the king. There was Deborah. She was a prophetess. God was speaking through her. Well, why did God use this woman to move the history of Israel another step closer? Why? Because the men weren't right with God. I mean, a lot of people bring up the idea of Deborah. Oh, she led the children of Israel into victory. She even said, "It's a shame to you, Barak, for having me come to battle with you. It's a shame to you. It's a shame to the man that here King Barak, God could have given him the same grace to win every battle for Israel. He could have been there as the victorious leader in the book of Judges. No, why do we got Deborah there? Why was she a judge for 40 years? Because no man took his place. They were being passive. They were just sitting there. They didn't have the chanza to do what they needed to do. They weren't being obedient to God. Because they were afraid to do what God commanded. They were afraid. A passive man is afraid. No, a man who's courageous does what God says. Because they know at the command of God is a power to do it. And it doesn't make sense, but God says so, and I'm doing it because I trust God. A passive man goes, well, I'm afraid. I really don't want to. I really can't. I really can't because, you know, this. I mean, I might just die. I might get hurt. I mean, things are kind of. That's what happens to a passive man. No, an active man says, God commands it, I'm doing it, and I don't care about the consequences because I'm going to please my God. That's what's important. It's the glory of God that's important. And if I die, I die, but God gets the glory. You got Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And they said to the ruler of the whole known world, Nebuchadnezzar, you're telling us to bow down to this gold statue you made. Well, we're not going to do it. Our God is the one in charge of everything. And He has the ability to save us. But even if He doesn't, we are not going to bow down to your statue. And so what did Nebuchadnezzar do? Go in the fiery furnace. In fact, because you defied me, fire it up 7 times hotter. And so the men who grabbed a hold of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, as they were trying to get them to throw them in the fiery furnace, they died on the spot because the fire was so high. His own men died trying to get Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to throw them in the fiery furnace. And there they are in there. And they're walking around. Wait a minute, how come they're walking around? The only thing burnt was the things that bound them. That's what was burnt. Their fears got burned up because they obeyed God. That's what bound them. And they're walking around free. It says, hey, wait a minute. Didn't we throw them 3 in there? There's another one. He looks like the Son of God. Hey, get them out of here. Pull them up. And they couldn't even smell smoke on them. And Nebuchadnezzar says, if anybody says anything bad against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, we're going to do bad things to them. No, we're going to honor this God. No, God saves like this. There is no God that can save except the one true God, Jesus Christ. He was in there in the furnace. when you are not passive but active, and I'm going to obey God regardless of the consequences, you know Jesus is with you to the very end of the age. Go ahead and do what God called you to do. Baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them everything I command you to do. And I'm with you. I'm not on my own. We're not on our own. We go and do what we're supposed to do. Well, in this church, they didn't have a man standing up, man enough to do what God has called him to do. So they're allowing this woman, who's a prophetess, and they call her Jezebel, to go and seduce people, to call, force them to err, to make mistakes, to do things that are sinful in God's sight. Now, the first church he talks to is the church of Ephesus. And he says to them, you know, I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne and hast patience for any. What did they do? When they saw somebody standing up and trying to teach something that wasn't the truth, they checked out everything they had to say with what God had already inspired. And if it didn't match up, they were out of there. If somebody says, oh, I'm a prophetess, oh, you have to listen, this is God, I'm speaking, God is going to speak right through me. And I say, doesn't match up with Scripture, get out of here. The Lord rebuke you in Jesus' name. Don't ever come back unless you repent. There is forgiveness if you repent, but if not, hey, you're out of here. They wouldn't even allow those kind of characters in their church. Praise God. And Jesus commended them for that. And we just let anybody into church for the most part in American church. People just accept everything. Oh, well, it must be God. I mean, it seems to make sense. And there's a lot of truth to what they say. Some of the stuff I don't understand, but there's some truth in that. And they just let any old prophetess show up and tell them what to do with their lives. We got a big problem here. You know, the first churches to marry gays were the churches that were pastored by women. The same church bodies that had women as pastors are the first churches to have homosexual pastors. That's the truth. This is the direction that this the Church of America is going. There's certain churches that say, I'm not going to deal with that. We're breaking from that. So we don't want nothing to do with something that God calls sin. Well, the devil seduced Eve, which means he lied to her, and she believed the lie. She knew what God's word said. Don't eat of the truth. Don't eat of the tree. That was it. Well, the devil didn't want that to happen. No, he's trying to remove God's love from these people who he created in his own image. So he seduced Eve. Where did he go to Eve? He went not to her mind, but to her emotions. And he basically said, did God really say that? Are you really sure? Is that what he really said? Well, God knows that if you do this, you'll be like him. So now the devil has implied evil intent upon God. The problem was, Adam was right there. She ate, and she gave the apple, well, whatever it was, that piece of fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, she gave it to her husband, who was with her. And he ate it. Who was with her? Which means that Adam watched this whole thing go on, and he was not man enough to stand up against the devil. God had given him authority over this entire planet. And he could have killed Satan. He could have killed that snake that was infected by Satan. And he didn't do it. He's saying, wow, look how beautiful she is. Oh, she's talking to the snake. And wow, some interesting things she's saying. Wow, isn't she beautiful? Oh, she's eating it. She didn't die. She's giving it to me. I guess I could eat it too. I don't know what went through Adam's head. She was seduced. She got lied to. But Adam sinned. He knew what was right. He knew what was wrong. And he did what was wrong, and he sinned. And God came to Adam first, because God holds the man accountable, because he's the one who's in charge. Now, Adam didn't go, oh, you're right, I'm sorry, I sinned, please forgive me. He says, what was that woman you gave me? She's the one that gave me that apple to eat. No, he's passing the buck. That's what sinners do. Oh, there's always a reason why I sin. It's not my fault. No, these guys, they were allowing this woman, Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, a self-proclaimed prophet. Now, give me a break. That means, oh, I'm a prophet. I have a word of God from you. How many churches are like that? They got people all over the place claiming they got a word of God from you. Well, if it's something that you've never heard before, chances are it isn't God. You know what I'm saying? I mean, God will bring somebody to you to confirm what God has already told you. God's not going to have somebody show up and tell you what you want to know and seduce you. No, the devil does that. The devil's trying to get you away. The word for seduce here, it comes from the word to err. It's planeo. It's the word we get planets from. If you look up at night, I know we live in a city, you don't see all the stars, but you can see some of the planets, you can see some of the stars. Why are planets called planets? Because they don't follow. If you would take a time-lapse photography and you look right up that way to the North Star and you point the camera right there, what are you going to see? In time-lapse photography, you're going to see a whole bunch of circles. Because all those stars are going around. They're not going around. It's us. And at night, you can see. And the movement is us moving. It's not the stars moving. But there's some other things up there that show light that don't move that way. They move in different directions. They seem to wander. That's why they're called planets, from the same word, planeo. Well, she is causing people to err, to wander off from the truth. She's causing them to wander from the truth. She's giving them something which isn't the truth. They're not following the truth. They're erring. Well, if somebody gives you the wrong directions to somewhere, are you going to get there? No, you're going to go to the wrong place. The Bible tells us how to get to heaven. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. There's the map. It's Jesus. And the whole book talks about him. All of history is focused on Jesus. It's his story. Well, she's causing them to err. She's seducing them. Well, she's called Jezebel. It's like, Jezebel. What a nasty name. Well, we know about Jezebel. She was married to King Ahab. Northern tribes, they went into apostasy, and Jezebel was the daughter of Ethbaal, the king of the Sidonians. Sounds like somebody from outer space. But this guy was the priest of Baal, and this is his daughter, who's the priestess of Baal. Well, they were supposed to worship the one true God and him only. Were they supposed to serve, not some other false gods? And there were commands already from Deuteronomy. Moses wrote, God said. If somebody tells you, let's go worship this other god, that person needs to be stoned. They need to die on the spot. Because they're going to cause you to err. You're going to wander off from the one true God. You'd be saving them and everybody else that might hear them speak from wandering from God, breaking covenant relationship with God, and going to hell for an eternity. It's a big deal. Well, Jezebel got married to the king. And she brought Baal worship into the northern tribes big time, and Ashtaroth worship. This Baal worship was basically whatever stronghold is anywhere, you're going to call that Baal, and you're going to worship that so that your grain is going to grow, so that your cows are going to reproduce, so that your sheep and your goats are going to reproduce. So you got everything that the earth is going to produce its best, and you're going to get rich if you worship Baal. And Ashtaroth was basically, the altar was like a phallic symbol, and it was a sexual cult. So, with your Baal worship, you get sexual immorality alongside. Isn't that great? You get everything that your body would want, everything that you want. You want to have riches, you want to have pleasure. There you go. And it was just filled with the northern tribes, completely into Baal worship. And she did whatever she wanted to do. And Ahab let her. There is a story of Ahab, and he sees this vineyard that was nearby their summer palace. Like, oh, I really want this other piece of property. I don't need a vineyard. I just need that other piece of property. And he tells Naboth, hey, I'll buy it. And he says, I can't sell it. He says, whatever you want, I don't care. I mean, I'm the king. I can give you anything you want. In fact, even raise your price. I don't care. He says, I can't sell it. I got this piece of property. I inherited it. For my ancestor was the one who received this inheritance from Joshua himself. This comes from God. It's wrong for me before God to sell it. I can't sell it. Oh, great. He's bringing in his old religion to keep me... this is terrible. So he's moaning and complaining and whining. Here's his wife. And how come you're not happy? What's the matter with you? Oh, I tried to buy Naaman's vineyards. You know, I can't have it. She says, I'll take care of it for you. You're king. What's the matter with you? He's passive. He's not doing what God commands. No, he's just passive. Letting this woman turn the entire religion of Israel over to Baal worship. And she trumps up charges against Naboth and his sons and has them all killed and gives the property to Ahab. See, I got the property for you, honey. It's not that big of a deal. I can give you anything you want. That was Jezebel. Well, the next king, next couple of kings, you know, she's still in charge. She's like the queen mother. Well, God decided to destroy it all. And there was actually, you know, remember the whole story of Elijah, Mount Carmel, we're going to have two altars here, do whatever you want with your guys and do whatever, jump up and down and scream and cut yourself and whatever. But the one true God's going to answer with fire. And they had their time, nothing happened. And then Elijah takes his altar, puts the stones back together from an original altar that was there that shows the 12 tribes of Israel, and he put all the wood on there and the sacrifice. And he says, keep dumping water on it. And dig a trench around it. Fill that up with water. And then he prays to God. Fire came down, devoured it, and says, Yahweh Jehovah God is God. And he says, kill them. And so all the people who saw that the one true God is God killed all the prophets of Baal and Ashtoreth. And Jezebel says, I'm going to kill you, Elijah. I'm going to kill you. Well, Elijah gives a nice little prophecy that basically says, you know, the dogs are going to eat you. You know, and you're going to be nothing but dog poop on the ground. Well, God had judgment against the household of Ahab. And there was a man named Jehu. And God gave him success. And Jehu did all kinds of stuff. He was killing anybody that had anything to do with Ahab and their family. I mean, it was God's hand of judgment. Now, Jehu didn't follow the ways of the Lord. He still allowed the rival altars of Bethel and Dan. He didn't follow things God's way, but he was still God's hand of judgment against the household of Ahab. And here, you know, Jezebel's this old lady. And he shows up at, you know, and there she is. And what does she do? Oh, let me get my face on, you know. So she does, the dude dads up her hair and gets her clothes and puts on her face. And she says, you know, are you the servant who kills his master? Well, she already knew what he did. And she says, is there anybody for me up there? Jehu says, is there anybody for me? And there's a couple of eunuchs. I'm sure it would have been horrible to have to work for this woman. And he says, anybody for me? And they said, yes, throw her out of the window. And they threw her out of the tower. She splatted on the ground. He says, I'm going to have some lunch. When he comes back from lunch, there was nothing left, just some parts of her. And it was a fulfillment of the prophecy that God spoke through Elijah. Now, that's how Jezebel ends. The idea of Jezebel is this person who brings in a false worship system, a person who basically takes authority over men, a person who seduces people to sin, who basically takes control over passive, weak-willed men so that they will do her bidding. There's lots of them out there. But this is the one who calls herself a prophetess. Now, anybody would call their daughter Jezebel after the stories of the Old Testament? Well, actually, there is. Ever heard the name Isabella? Same name. It's the same word. Same word. Isabella. Isn't that a great name? Isn't that a pretty name? Well, it's the same thing. It basically means, or the word chastity means the same thing. Well, that doesn't mean somebody named Chastity, same name as Jezebel, but it can mean the same thing. So it's not like an unheard of name. But I personally don't think there actually was a person named Jezebel there, even though it could have been. Very easily could have been. But what's interesting is that Jezebel had a husband who was supposed to have authority, but she was the one who had authority. That's the idea. Chances are, the pastor of the church at Thyatira's wife was the Jezebel, who was a prophetess. That's how she got in to take authority. She married a passive man. And he was more than willing to let her do whatever she wanted. And she seemed to be really popular, and seemed to really, you know, have lots of folks were coming, and they were buying her, you know, DVDs and books and tapes and that, and they were watching her TV program, and she was on TBN with everybody else, and, you know, everybody really liked her, and they were all coming, you know, by, you know, 30,000 people would show up when she's coming to visit your town to speak. She even has a $15,000 marble toilet. All I have to say, there's lots of Jezebels out there in Christianity today. And the passive men have no problem sitting under her teaching. Well, she's teaching them. She's taking authority that doesn't belong to her. She's a self-proclaimed prophet, which means she's saying, God is speaking through me. Well, there isn't any prophet that just says lies all the time, because nobody would listen to him. No, every single person who says a self-proclaimed prophet has lots of things that are true. And if you read the New Age books and the New Agers that are coming into Christianity books that you can buy at any Christian bookstore, you're going to see a lot of stuff that sounds biblical. I mean, you can go to Unity Church and they're going to use the Bible there. You can see all the books and stuff by guideposts, and you're going to say, oh yeah, they're biblical, they're Christian. They are not. It's all New Age. They just got a Christian sound to them because they use the Bible and they use some Bible passages. What are they doing? They're seducing Christians to the New Age movement. That's what they're doing. That's what they're doing. It's pretty sad. It's been happening in America for a long time. Anyway, she calls herself a prophetess. She teaches to seduce my servants to commit fornication. She's getting people to commit fornication? How could she do that? Well, I talked about the guilds. If you wanted a job, you got to get in with a union. But if you get into a union, it's a guild, and you have to swear to be under the authority of the god of that trade guild. Which means you are serving that false god. Well, that would never happen in this country, wouldn't it? There's all kinds of secret societies. And you can see the little things and the bumper stickers that these guys are really proud of. It's called Freemasonry. It's called the Elks. It's called Eagles. I mean, there's all these different secret orders, fraternal orders. You got to say an oath to them. You are putting yourself under oath when you belong to one of these things. If you're putting yourself under oath, that means I am coming under your authority, which is not the authority of God's Word, and it's not the authority of Jesus Christ. Now, these guys, if they needed work, they're going to go, this is my skill, this is my craft, this is what I do for a living, the only way I can get a job is to be there. And she's saying, what's really important is that you feed your family, and you're a good dad, and you're good a supporter, and this is a way to make money. Plus, it's good for the church, because you'll be able to support our ministry, and we'll be able to make lots of money. And, you know, God doesn't want you poor. I mean, there's all kinds of rhetoric we hear today where the end justifies the means of how you're going to get rich quick. But it's seduction. The end doesn't justify the means. Why? Because God is in charge of the ends, and He holds us accountable for the means. That's the reality. You don't need to be a part of the Freemasons to be able to have the right to be an evangelist in some city where the other Freemasons who, you know, are associated with, you know, the newspaper and the TV stations will pump you up and make you look good in front of the city and you'll get everybody to come. Yeah, but the unjustifies the means. I get to preach the gospel and people are going to get saved because they hear the gospel. So you got to be a Freemason to do that? No, it's part of this seduction. You're not going to do it God-pleasing. You're not going to get any reward for it for an eternity. It's all going to burn because it's all about you looking good. It's not about doing things Jesus' way. Well, for whatever she said, however she seduced them, they are now committing fornication and eating things sacrificed to idols. Well, I can understand sacrificing things to idols. That's what happens if you go to some idol temple and you're going to worship some false god. You're going to eat the food that's part of the fellowship offering. What gets burned up to them and the rest of it, I burn up with my body. And we're all together. We're all brothers and we're all... That's the whole idea of eating food sacrificed to idols. Tell them it's okay. Well, that idol isn't anything. There's only one true God, so go ahead and do that. Well, Paul talks about that in 1 Corinthians 10. Yeah, there is only one true God. But he says, I'm not going to do anything that's going to cause somebody to sin. I'm going to do all things for all men that I may save some. I'm not going to do anything that's going to cause somebody to sin. But what about this fornication thing? Every one of these idol temples... Why were they so popular? Because they had prostitutes. Every last idol temple's got a prostitute. And it's the same to this day. If you go to Thailand, you can buy a child to have sex with. That's their big trade. And they're slaves. Slavery, there's more slaves in the world today than there's ever been since the history of man. If you, in India, there are prostitutes in these temples. Southeast Asia. I mean, we're talking about today. Now, in the Greek culture, that was so normal. That's the way it always was. In order to become a man, you had to have sex with one of the prostitutes of the temple that your dad goes to be a man. Or you wouldn't be a man. And you'd be ridiculed by every other guy who's your peer. And you'd be ridiculed by their fathers because you didn't do this. And in your heart as a Christian, you're going to know it's wrong, it's immoral, but your flesh is going to say, well, this is going to be fun, this is going to be exciting, this is going to be neat. It's no different than what we saw at our last church. There were these passion parties that were going through our last church. And some of the ladies were getting together and selling basically sex toys and things and having private little, you know, it's kind of like Tupperware or whatever. But it wasn't Tupperware. Some of these men, God saved from being addicted to pornography, and now their wife is going to go to a passion party and get them sucked back into pornography again. What are you doing? What's the matter with you people? And even the pastor's daughter was selling this stuff. And it was okay. And these wives were telling intimate secrets with other wives about their relationship, their own personal, intimate sexual relationship with their husband. Give me a break. God is not pleased with this stuff. And it's going on to this day. And the problem that Jesus had with the church is that they allowed it. Now this stuff is going to happen. We live in a sin-cursed culture and there's more paganism everywhere that you look. But you don't have to let it come in through the doors of your church. The problem was they allowed it. They allowed this woman to take authority over the church and to allow people to think it's okay to have... Now here, the word is fornication, but it's also the idea of adultery. Down here, behold, I will cast her into a bed, verse 22, and them that commit adultery with her. So it's not just the men who've never gotten married, it's the men who are married. They're breaking their covenant with their wife, and in the process, they are both, married and unmarried, breaking their covenant with their God. We've got so much internet porn, and so much porn that isn't even considered porn. They, you know, there's these churches and they bought the rights to be able to play the Super Bowl. Some of them got really nicked bad because they played the Super Bowl and they had to shut them down because they weren't supposed to play the Super Bowl. But hey, it's a great thing and your church can get together and watch the Super Bowl in church, isn't it? Because you got the big screens anyway, right? Might as well watch the Super Bowl. Isn't it going to be real? The commercials are filled with pornography. If you just, as a woman, show a little piece of skin, you're going to have every man's eye on you. You're going to use the way God made a man, and you're going to use it to bring him to sin. Well, that was what was happening here, and it's happening to this day. People in some of these churches, they got family movie night. Well, you got to be really, 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 really careful. What kind of movie are you going to be saying, hey, this is okay for my church to watch? Most of them don't have a biblical worldview. And the ones that do, they still got these nasty little things here and there because you got to make sure you're going to make money, and you're not going to make money if you don't have some pornography in there. Pornography is anything that's going to allow someone to have sexual pleasure outside of marriage. It doesn't have to be nudity, it doesn't have to be sex. It can be anything that is seductive sexually. It's pornography. It's porneia. You turn on TV and you're not going to have some ugly person selling you some product. No, she's got to be, you know, a body that isn't natural, and she's got to have skin tight clothes on or not having much on there at all in order to sell you this product. That's not to be in a Christian's home. It's not to be in the church especially. You're better off killing your TV set and destroying your computer than to allow your mind and your eyes to see what you shouldn't see. And if you've got a friend who thinks it's funny, they're looking for an excuse to pull somebody in to the porn that they are addicted to, have nothing to do with them. They're not your friend. I just have to say that. People who are addicted to porn have a really tough time getting out of it. Because as they struggle, and as they pray, and as they fast, and as they do whatever they need to do, the urge gets getting stronger and stronger, and the devil says, well, just do it, and you'll feel better. But then it's even stronger the next time as they try not to do it. And then as they try not to do it, all of a sudden, for no apparent reason, they're overwhelmed with this thought, oh, I gotta do it, I gotta have some porn. And they're working, and they go out to throw out the trash, and right there in the trash is porn for them. The devil sets them up to be once again caught in that bondage. And you're addicted to the chemicals in your own brain, of your brain's making. Those chemicals are there on purpose by God, so that you're going to fall in love with your wife and never want anybody else for the rest of your life. That's what it's there for. It's in the woman's body for her to fall in love with her husband and not want anybody else but her husband for the rest of her life as well. God made us this way. It's not to be used for our own addiction to the chemicals of our own body. I just have to say that because this is reality here. He says, don't let this woman do this anymore. You allowed it. Now, verse 21, he says, and I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. Says, I already gave her lots of time to repent. Now this is amazing. Why didn't God kill her on the spot? He gave her time to repent. Now this is an amazing God of grace who's going to give even this person who is grandstanding herself as some self-proclaimed prophetess causing people to sin. You know, it's really easy to be a prophet and have lots of people addicted to you if you tell them what they want to hear. And they won't stop coming. I mean, they'll call you at every time of day and night because they want to hear from God through you. You got a word from God. And the ones who are connected to the demons, they know what people want to hear. And they're going to tell them that. And women, I'm going to say, because the way God made them, God made women to feel. Their emotions are connected with every thought in their mind. Everything they have to do is connected to their feelings. Everything is connected. God made them that way so that they could cry when their baby falls down. When their child comes with a skinned knee, their child's going to know, Mommy hurts like I hurt. And they do. And I need my mommy to know what it hurts. I need to know that. And that's all I need. I just need to know that she knows and I'm good. And I'm up. And I'm hurting myself again. God made him that way. Now the devil used that and lied to her. He got to her feelings. And seduced her by means of her feelings. Well, it wasn't fair that God doesn't want me to be like him. He got to her feelings. That's the way every prophetess gets seduced by Satan. The devil is the greatest counterfeiter. I can hear God, and I know it's God. And this is how I know. This is what God always sounds like. This is what God always feels like. And Satan knows exactly what I feel, exactly what God sounds like, in my body, in my heart, in my emotions. Because as much as we can go to the doctor and have all kinds of tests, and they could just put little things on us, get an EKG, they can see where, you know, they could put a lie detector, and they can see where our body's getting warmer, where there's more circulation, they can get the things in our brain and see what parts of our brains are kicking in by the different things going on. The devil can scan us the same way, and he can completely and perfectly counterfeit, and I know it was God. No, you don't know it was God. Because the devil can counterfeit that. That's why when he shows up and he's going to inhabit the Antichrist, people are going to be absolutely positive that's Jesus Christ. Because he's the perfect counterfeiter. Yes, as a woman you can be deceived. Know that that's the truth. Because that means whatever you hear that you are sure it's from God, you got to go back to Scripture. You got to know, is this the way that God... Is this sin? Is this close to sin? Is this something else? I need to know. Just because you get something from God, you just don't run with it. Because it might not be God. You need a confirmation. Now, I'm just saying this. Because we've had folks from here that were just... All of a sudden, some word came up. Fine. But if it's not from God, it's not from God. When a prophet speaks, and you can go to 1 Corinthians, 12 and 14, and talks about it. He says, the other prophets, everybody, you got to test it. Is it from God? You test it. It's not about, nobody can say anything. No, the Holy Spirit's going to choose who he wants to choose to speak through. If a woman's going to prophesy, she needs to be under the authority of some man. If she's a widow, she needs to be under the authority of the pastor. If she's married, she needs to be under the authority of her husband. If she's not married, she's under the authority of her father. Everything she does is under that authority. I mean, she can't just be out there. She's got to ask first. Now, that's kind of tough for a woman. But Satan knows how God created her. She is more easily seducible. And part of the curse, which means part of the consequences of her sinning, was what? He will rule over you. You're not in charge, he is. Your desire will be for your husband. He will rule over you. That means that there is an authority over every woman from the time they're born. He will rule over you. Now, it's not like she's got the worst lot of the consequences for sin, but every woman needs to know that he will rule over you. There is a man who needs to be an authority over you. Can a man not be deceived? A man can be deceived, but usually when a man is deceived is because he has been pursuing sin. There's some sin that he loves that the Holy Spirit's been telling him about, and the devil is right there giving him some piece of rhetoric to feel good about the sin that he's in. That's how a man gets deceived. He jumps in with both feet in some sin and the Holy Spirit's been convicting him and he's not listening to conviction. So the devil is right there making him feel good about himself in his sin so that he can put his head to sleep at night and know, okay, I'm okay with God because It's okay. I'm deserving of doing this. It's not my fault, or it's somebody else's fault, or this is the way God made me, or all these stupid things that the devil tells a man so that he can continue in his sin. So there's a difference between deception for a man and deception for a woman. A woman's going to be deceived by her emotions. A man's going to be deceived because he's already pursuing a sin. Okay. So, she's telling them and seducing them to sin. Now, who is she telling and seducing to sin? Christians. These aren't just other pagans. Well, pagans have been sinning for decades. I mean, for millennia. They don't know any better and they love it. But no, these are Christians who are being convinced to do something wrong. And I gave her space to repent of her fornication. I gave her space. I gave her time. God gave her time. God's not willing for any to perish but all to come to repentance. He's patient. Why? Because he died for her sins. And her worship is due him. But if she's not going to repent, then he just wasted his blood on the cross for her. He's going to be patient for her to repent. And she repented not. Behold, I will cast her in a bed. Well, this word for bed is basically the couch that you would lay at, recline at, to eat at a table. It's not like sitting in a chair and there's a table here. You're going to be reclining on this cushion, but it's more than a cushion, it's actually like a couch. But it's also the kind of couches that were there in these pagan temples, where you're eating of food that was already to give glory to this pagan god, and it's also that couch, that bed by which you're going to have your immoral relationship with some priestess of that god or goddess. So he's saying, okay, you're really into the bed thing? I'll give you a bed to lie in. This isn't a good bed. Some of the translations will say a sick bed, which means this bed is not where you want to be. There's another bed. It's called a coffin. You lay down there, you don't get up. That's the consequences for sin. The sinner that sins, he shall die. There's a consequence for not repenting. It's called death. This is clear. This is biblical. And you can play around with sin for a long time and get away with it. But consequences are death. So it's like, I'll give you a bed to lay in, and you ain't getting back up. And them that commit adultery with her in great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. Now this isn't talking about the great tribulation, because that's not going to happen for a few more chapters here. This is great tribulation. Now, that means what? God has taken their relationship with him seriously. God is taking their godliness seriously. God is taking their pursuit of holiness seriously. God is taking their eternal rewards seriously, more than they are. So he's a good dad and he's going to spank. We can go back to Hebrews 12. And Hebrews 12 is all about, we've got a good dad. And because he's a good dad, he's going to spank us. He's going to give us the discipline that we need because he's not going to leave us in the place that he found us. He cares more about our holiness, our eternal rewards, our righteousness, the testimony of our life, the legacy of our life, than we do. And he's going to make it happen. If it takes us kicking and screaming all the way, it's not going to be pleasant for us. But he's going to accomplish his will through our life. So what is he going to do? He's going to give them great tribulation. It's not going to be pleasant. Which means what? They belong to him. They are his children. So he's going to spank them. He's going to spank them hard. He's going to get their attention. And they're going to repent. Now, doesn't sound like Jezebel saved. She might be. Because she got time to repent. But I don't think she was. But these people, he's going to give them great tribulation. He's going to do whatever it takes to get their attention so that they do repent. Now, this is a loving God. And a loving dad is not going to let somebody get away with something to their own destruction. He's not going to let their child get away with something to their own destruction. He's going to have to punish them because he loves them. Verse 23, and I will kill her children with death. Now, killing with death sounds kind of weird. What does it mean to kill with death? Well, this is a Hebrewism, which means the consequence is death. Killing with death. The thing is, the book of Revelation is a very Hebrew book, and so we're going to come across a lot of Hebrewisms in here. And all the churches shall know that I am he which searches the reins and the hearts. Well, what does it mean, her children? Does that mean her kids? Her own kids? The pastor's kids and the pastor's wife's kids and Mrs. Pastor's kids? No. It's talking about all those who have come under the authority of her teaching. They're her children. Whoever is listening to her and always turns on a radio program and always watches her on TV and all, those are her children. Who do everything she says and buys all of her books, those are her children. And I will kill her children with death. And all the churches shall know that I am he which searches the reins and the hearts. Now what's going to happen when they die? They're going to know that the one true God looks at the heart. You can't get away with sin. God is going to do something about it. When the tribes that didn't want to go across the Jordan River said, hey, this is great for our cattle, we just want to stay here, Moses took it to the Lord. He says, hey, they don't want to come into the promised land. He says, okay, well, they can stay there. But tell them this, be sure and know that if you don't come over, if your men don't come over to fight Israel's battles, you're just going to be happy over on that side. Be sure and know this, your sin will find you out. And that's what happens every time. One of God's kids is continuing in sin, and I guarantee God's going to make sure you get caught. Because he's a good dad, and he cares more about you than your sexual pleasure, your sinful pleasure. No, he wants to stop that cold dead, and he wants you to pursue holiness and righteousness, something that gives him pleasure. I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he which searches the reins and the hearts. Well, reins basically is a word for kidneys. The heart, I look at the kidneys and the heart. Well, kidneys have to do with your feelings, and the heart has to do with your desires. So you could say he searches the minds and the hearts. I mean, if you think about kidneys when you have feelings, I mean, you're going to understand, anybody knows, you know, any kid who wets the bed because they had a scary dream knows there is a lot of emotions in the kidneys. I guarantee it. That's the way it is. So that's how the Greeks saw it. That's how the Romans saw it. So that's what we got here. Now, I search the mind and the heart, your intentions, your desires, and your feelings. I can look all the way down there. Jesus is the one with the eyes of fire. He can see all that stuff that's hidden. He knows every thought. He knows our desires. He knows what is pleasing. He knows how we are planning to do some sin as soon as we get the opportunity to get away with it. He knows all that. He searches it. And when God brings down the hammer, everybody's going to take him seriously. Now, did that ever happen? Yeah, Ananias and Sapphira. We talked about that story before. These two people were going to church. They saw Barnabas sell a large piece of property and give the money to the church that the church could take care of these poor people in the congregation. And they thought, hey, we could do that. But we don't want to give all the money because we want to live on the money. It still belongs to us. But the problem was, they could have done that. Problem was, they said that the amount that they were giving to the church was the full amount. So they lied to the church, they lied to the Holy Spirit. And they showed up before Peter and they dropped dead. Because it was hypocrisy. Ananias and Sapphira, scary story. I wish that happened more often. Because what was the result? There was the fear of God in the church. All of a sudden, people took God seriously. God is going to take your sin seriously. He's going to take your behavior seriously. He's going to take your desires seriously. God sees. God knows. And people had a fear of the Lord. They took God seriously. What was the result? They were more actively pursuing what God desired. They were more actively running away from what they knew was sin. They were more actively pursuing God's commandments. He says, "And I will give unto every one of you according to your works." I talked about the Bema Seat judgment to begin with. That's what God does. Whatever we've done in the name of Jesus will remain. Whatever we've done for our love for our Savior is what He's going to give us an eternal reward for. This isn't how to get to heaven. Got to be good enough to get to heaven. No, nobody's going to be good enough. The moment you did any sin, you go to hell for an eternity. Just missed it. No, everybody misses it by a lot. We all fall short of the glory of God. Nobody can make it. That's why Jesus had to be obedient in our place. That's why He had to be crucified for every bad thing we would do. That's the only way anybody gets to heaven, is by the grace of God, by Jesus Christ alone. No, we get rewards for what we've done to His glory. Then verse 24, "But unto you I say, and unto the rest of Thyatira, but unto you." Why say unto you? Well, there is a them and there's a you. He's talking to the believers. He's talking about the bad stuff that's going on in their church, but he's talking to the people who really do love the Lord, who have the love and have the service and have the works and have the perseverance. "But unto you I say, and the rest in Thyatira, as many as have not this doctrine, and have not known the depths of Satan as they speak, I will put upon you none other burden." It's like, you got enough work as it is. You got enough burden as it is. I'm not on your case. I'm not putting any extra burden on you. Because you aren't following Jezebel's teaching. You're not under her authority. And you're also, you aren't knowing the depths of Satan. Depths of Satan. Ooh. That sounds kind of neat. I want to know these secret things. No, you don't. You don't want to know these secret things. Because every secret thing you know comes with strings attached, comes with bondages to Satan. Every last person who I've known who's gotten into the occult, the end result is God's going to let Satan do what he wants to do in your life. He's going to give you over. And giving them over sends them to self-destruction. The people in the occult that I've seen, they either commit suicide or attempt it. If God doesn't allow them to die, they get into severe drug use and alcoholism, or obesity, where they're killing themselves a little every day. They're cutting themselves. They're doing these things. He just allows the devil to take them over. There's consequences for learning these deep depth secrets of Satan. You know, there's some Christians who think, well, I just want wisdom wherever it's found. And they really have this morbid interest in the occult. Well, the occult just means something that's hidden. So I want to see what's hidden. I want to find out all these truths. And they get into this stuff, and there's horrible consequences. There seems to be a 1-to-1 ratio with alcoholism with people getting into the occult. Or drug abuse. Some people get into the occult because they were into drug abuse first. The other ones get into drug abuse after they've been into the occult. Either way, it doesn't end well. So he says, you don't know those things. Praise God. Stay ignorant of these things. You don't need to know. You really don't need to know. You don't want to learn what they know. You know, the Ephesian congregation, when they were getting saved, they had all these occultic books. They were delving into the depths of Satan. And when these people got saved, they didn't say, oh, well, we could sell this and give this money to the church. We'd give it to the poor. We'd make all this money for God. No, what did they do with those occultic books? They burned them all. And they were worth millions and millions of dollars. They destroyed them. So nobody else is going to be affected by those teachings. And Jesus is saying, you know, you haven't known it. Praise God. There isn't any information that the devil's going to grab a hold of you and take you into bondage. Praise God. You don't need to know. You don't need to know. You don't need to know. If you got a friend who's going to say, hey, we can do this funky thing with the Ouija board, or hey, we can do this kind of thing, and you press your eyes and you say, oh, Bloody Mary, or you do all these weird funky things that are just creepy. Or you watch the horror movies. I mean, I know some Christians who, the kids really got into the Goosebump movies. I mean, Goosebump books. Well, they're having nightmares. Why are they having nightmares? Because they are reading about demonic stories. Ugly, nasty things. Who wants nightmares? Well, by reading this stuff and you're learning the depths of Satan, what happens? Now Satan has got a string on you, and while you're sleeping and there's nothing you can do about it, he's going to torment you. Because you are learning the dark depths of Satan. Or the crazy Harry Potter things. You know, after just reading the first book, you have gone through the first 2 years of witches and sorcery training. You're learning, oh, it's just a book. Oh, it's just fantasy literature. No, it isn't. It is not. It is these depths of Satan. And what happens? These kids are... They don't think it's any big deal. Yeah, you can like play around casting spells. Yeah, you can do this kind of stuff. You can see things actually do happen. They get sucked into it. And there's horrible consequences. Every last one of them, they got to repent. They've got to deny. They've got to say, I want nothing to do with this. This is of Satan. And you burn what you got. Huge consequences. Because people aren't going to follow the one true Lord if they are able to see real things happen by doing certain things. Well, it's kind of like Christianity. You're praying. Yeah, witches pray more than Christians do. They're trying to proclaim into being what doesn't exist, just like the Word of Faithers do. It is occult. It's demonic. Have nothing to do with it. It has horrible consequences. Okay. Verse 25. But that which ye have already, hold fast until I come. You already know the truth. You're already holding tight. You're already doing those things that are pleasing to me. Just keep on doing it. Hold on tight. I know what's going on in your church. I know what's going on in your town. Hold on tight. And he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron as the vessels of potter. Shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received of my Father. Okay, you overcome, which means what? You're not doing the bad stuff that the people in church are doing. You're not doing the bad stuff that the people of your town are doing. You're overcoming. You're doing things Jesus' way. And it's not coming at a small cost. It's going to be hard to feed your family. It's hard. It's going to be, you're not going to have friends. Things aren't going to work well for you. Because you're not going to be a friend of the world. But you're going to overcome. And to those who do that, to him will I give power. That's the word authority. That means autonomy. It's going to give authority over the nations. At P is upon the nations, which means you're going to get authority. Well, that's not in this world. Because there's no place in this world where Christians really are in charge. And any people who could proclaim themselves to be Christians who get into positions of authority after the way they voted on things in Congress, you know that they're not Christians. You know, it's like, okay, a Christian wouldn't vote for that. You want to stay in office, so you're going to sin instead. And you're not representing me anymore, and I refuse to vote for you. That's not representative government. No, but if you overcome, you keep his works to the end, you're going to get a power. You're going to have power. You're going to have authority. Well, who has power and authority over the nations? Jesus does. And, well, is that talking about heaven? We're going to have power and authority over the nations in heaven? No, that's not... Heaven is everybody worshiping Jesus. I mean, that doesn't happen in heaven. Where does it happen? It's called the millennium. We are going to rule and reign at Jesus' side. And as we've been faithful with what God has placed in our hands, we are going to be given responsibility on the world to come during the millennium. Jesus is going to rule and reign. He's going to fulfill every promise that God made to Israel. He, as the angel Gabriel said, is going to sit on the seat of his father David, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, ruling from Jerusalem. And we're going to be ruling at his side in the millennium. Now, we're not going to be humans like we are now. We're going to be humans with a resurrected body. Resurrected body that is glorified. No more sin, no more inkling to sin, not even being tempted. We're going to have a body like when Jesus was resurrected from the dead, and all of a sudden he'd appear in a room. He could walk through a closed door. Nothing would stand in his way. Whatever he wanted to do, he did. We're going to have authority upon the nations. We're going to have autonomy. We can do what we want, and we're going to rule at Jesus' side. It's not as though we are the ones making the rules. Jesus is making the rules, and we are under his authority, and they will be under our authority. Why? Because there is going to be people who survive the Great Tribulation, and they're going to repopulate the planet. And these people who are giving birth and repopulating the planet are repopulating the planet with what? Sinners. So we're going to be ruling and reigning at Jesus' side. As we've been faithful in this life when things are tough here, we will be given authority during the millennium. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and the vessels of potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received of my Father. Jesus is saying he is going to rule with a rod of iron. He is ruling with a rod of iron. Well, we don't see that yet. But when are we going to see that? When all the enemies have been destroyed under Jesus' feet and he will rule with a rod of iron. We go to, this is a direct reference to Psalm 2. A rod of iron, this word for rod is the same kind of word that the shepherd would have. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And that word rule is the word for shepherd. We're going to shepherd. He's going to shepherd. Well, who are the sheep? It's the people who are reproducing and filling the planet after the Great Tribulation. But the rod of iron is not just like this wooden stick that the shepherd might use to scatter off the wolves and to scatter off the lions and whatever it is that's getting in the way or correcting his own sheep. A rod of iron is something that can break stones. A rod of iron can break heads. This isn't just something that you're going to correct a disobedient sheep with. This is something, nothing's going to stand in his way. Anything that would stand in his way is going to be broken like a piece of pottery. If you got some ceramic stuff, like a plate, what happens if you drop the plate? Breaks into a bunch of little pieces. Well, if you took that plate and you set it on the ground and you took a rod of iron and you smashed it, well, that's what's going to happen to anybody who gets in Jesus' way because he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's Jesus coming back to judge. That's Jesus coming back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Nobody's going to stand in his way, and we will reign at his side. Reigning not as the Gentiles reign, as the authoritarians in this world that kill people because they're getting in their political way. No, reigning as a shepherd reigns. Taking care of people. It's a whole different way of ruling and reigning. Verse 28, and I will give him the morning star. Wow, you get the morning star. Well, what's that? Well, before the sun comes up, certain planets or certain stars will be really extra bright. Because as the sun is starting to come up, most of the other stars are disappearing. But there'll be some at the horizon that still shine. And it's going to shine really bright before the sun comes up. Well, Jesus is called the bright and morning star. It's the brightest star. This is a reference to Jesus Christ. You overcome. What's more important? Being in charge of people? Having some kind of reward? What's more important? The most important thing when you get to heaven is Jesus. Anybody who loves Jesus And they're there in their last dying moments. Are they looking forward to seeing dead loved ones? No, they're looking forward to seeing Jesus. They're just waiting for Jesus to come and take them home. They're waiting for Jesus to fulfill His promise. I go away, but I'm coming back to take you in a place. I have prepared a place for you. In My Father's house are many dwelling places. Many mansions. I'm taking you home. We're waiting for Jesus to take us home. Those who overcome this pagan culture, we get Jesus. The brightest one. The first one. The one that gets all of our undivided attention. We get Jesus. This world and everything it's got to offer and what we don't get and all the stuff we got to suffer here, it's worth nothing unless we get Jesus. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Do we have ears to hear what the Holy Spirit is telling us? Are we listening to the warnings and the rebuke that Jesus is giving this pagan church? Now, when we were talking in the previous church, Pergamos had some problems. But the problems of Pergamos were teachings and theological problems that the world had come into the church and they were teaching worldly things. And they were kind of like absorbing things. But it was only in the thinking process. It was, okay, we're playing around with theological ideas here. We're going to have some kind of theological bull session and see what's okay, what's not okay, what seems to be acceptable, what we can deal with. By the time you get to Thyatira, these guys had already bought into the world's way of doing things, and it was their behavior that had now changed. They were sinning and thinking that God was okay with it. And sinning gross sins that have real big consequences in this life, and thinking God was okay with it. That's the next step in apostasy. And they were allowing people to just promote their false doctrine. Well, here they were allowing somebody, a self-proclaimed prophetess, to teach people to sin. No, we need to have an ear. We need to listen. We need to take seriously this warning. Our culture is getting worse all the time. You know, the church, the word for church is ecclesia. It's the called out ones. We are called out of the world. That's what it means to be the church. The church isn't the building. The church is the people, the called out ones. We are the church. If the called out ones are no longer, they've been called, but they're not out, you can't tell. You know, the church, we call it a fellowship, right? It's our fellowship. Well, the fellowship is everybody who's in that ship, all the fellows in the ship, right? Well, why are you in the ship? Because you'd drown if you were in the water. But what's happening to these last two churches was there was more of the world, more of the ocean, more of the water in the ship than the fellows. It's a worldly church. The first one was theologically worldly. This one goes beyond just playing around with theological thoughts to the point where you couldn't even tell the world from the church anymore. Well, in the American church, you can't. If you look at divorce, it is the same between people who don't know the Lord to people who are in church. Same rates. If you look at pornography and who's doing it, who's getting into it, who's buying it, same rates. People in the church, people out of the church. You see people with a nice Christian bumper sticker on the back of their car, but they're exceeding the speed limit. They're cutting in front of people. They're tailgating folks because they're not moving fast enough. Take the bumper sticker off. If you're not going to drive like a Christian, don't tell everybody that you're a Christian. What's the matter with you? You know what I'm saying? If you got a Christian t-shirt on, then don't be using bad language in the world. If you're going to self-proclaim yourself as, I'm part of the Ecclesia, I'm part of the called out ones, then you better be the one who's studying the hardest in school. You better be the one who's getting your work done in school. You better be the one who's exemplary in the workplace, who is submitting to all the rules and is not pushing back on whatever the boss is saying. If you're going to show yourself to be the Christian, you better be the adult. If you're the Christian in the relationship, then you better show yourself to be the mature Christian. And not the one who's got to dominate the room, and not the one who's got to dominate the relationship. You know what I'm saying? If we are the Christian, we need to show the world that we're the Christian. We're the called out ones. Called out ones doesn't mean, well, yeah, I went forward and I proclaimed Jesus and, you know, I'm going to go to heaven now. It means I'm called out. I'm no longer like the world. I'm going to do exactly what Jesus told me to do. I'm not going to let anything get in the way of what Jesus told me to do. Are we called out or we're not? Are we looking more like the world or we're not? Do we want to make our friends like us and do stuff just like them? Or are we called out? Do we really want to serve the Lord? Or do we want to serve whatever the pagan world has to say? Well, we need to have ears to hear. We need to listen what the Spirit is saying to the churches. We got to do things Jesus' way. He's the one that we please. He's the one that we obey. And you know what? We aren't going to be popular. People aren't going to like us because we're not going to use their language. We're not going to go watch their movies. We're not going to support their ugly, nasty things that they do. We're going to tell our friend, if you're into porn, I can't spend any more time with you because I don't want to fall into the bondage that you're under. If you're going to smoke that dope, I want nothing to do with you because I want to live a pure life. My body doesn't belong to me. It belongs to my Lord Jesus Christ who purchased me with His holy precious blood. And if you're going to lose your relationship, what are you going to get? The bright in the morning star forever. You're going to be with Jesus forever. Or do you want to just be like the rest of the world? Doing whatever they do, saying whatever they say, seeing whatever they see. We have to have an ear to hear. Are we called out ones or not? If we are, let's live it. It's very easy to do things the world's way. And the world likes us that way. When we are called out ones and we are living as called out ones, they don't like us anymore. Praise God. We have just kept ourselves from a whole lot of opportunity for the devil to tempt us to do things that are going to break my Jesus heart. I don't have to break my Jesus heart no more. I'm called out to serve Him. I want to overcome. I want the morning star. I want Jesus Christ more than I want anybody liking me. More than I want to be popular. More than I want to have success in this life. I want the bright morning star. I want the lover of my soul, Jesus. That's all I want. He loved me enough to die on the cross for my sins. I want Him. That's all I want. Heaven is not heaven if Jesus isn't there, and that's all I want. I just want Jesus. If all we want is Jesus for an eternity, that's all we want now. And if we want something besides Jesus now, we got to wonder, is that really all we want for eternity? No, the overcomers, we get the morning star. We get Jesus. And anybody who loves Jesus, that's all we want. Nothing in this life is important anyway. It's all going to burn. It's all connected with something ugly and filthy and nasty and worldly anyway. There's no pleasure in anything that doesn't give pleasure to Jesus anyway. All I want is Jesus. I want to have an ear to hear. Lord Jesus, we ask that You help us. Lord, let us see sin as You see it, Lord. Let us see how ugly it is, how nasty it is, how utterly horrible it is as it lies about who You are. And it lies to us about what You've made us to be, what You called us, what You called us out of. So Lord, we ask that You help us, Lord. Let us take the admonishment here from the Scriptures and live accordingly, dear God. And we thank You, Lord, that You accept all those people who repent, who turn from their sin and they turn to You. We turn to You and You turn to us. You accept everyone who comes to You. We thank You, Lord, that You'll never allow us to be snatched out of Your grasp. We thank You, Lord, for what You have done and for what You are doing. And we thank you, Lord, that you are making yourself real in the lives of these people who are self-proclaimed whatevers. And you're going to put them on the bed of their own choosing. Lord, we want to see you as real too. Lord, we want to live in a fear of the Lord. Not because we're afraid of the hammer, but because we love you. And we're afraid of sinning against the blood that was shed for us, Lord. We ask that you help us, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for these words from your word that you gave to the churches. In Jesus' name, amen.